Welcome to Recently Logged, where we don't like Chris Columbus, but at least he directed this, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, he did.
Wow, I guess we don't have to. I guess we can just skip basic facts.
Yeah, pretty much.
That's at first, my first thought for the intro was going to be where we make our upload schedule disappear. but I ended up going with that instead.
Wow, okay. So,
because I dislike Chris Columbus's movies most of the time.
Yeah, well, I wouldn't. See, there's the thing. I don't like Chris Columbus.
As a man?
As a person.
Wow.
But, like, the Harry Potter movies that he did were fine.
And, I mean, Rent is, like, five stars.
No. Adventures in Babysitting is fine. Home Alone's fine.
Oh, right. I was like, didn't we do Home Alone on the podcast? But we never did. We made the episode art for it and everything.
Yeah, we were going to, and then we just never did.
I don't remember why. It was, the family was in town.
We couldn't.
We just ran out of time.
All right, well, do we want to just jump right into it and go over the basic fact?
The basic fact. It is a Harry Potter movie.
It is a Harry Potter movie. All right.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, let's do it. Okay, Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone is a 2001
oh my God.
PG movie. It's 152 minutes.
Did I put Philosophers on the episode?
I hope so. It was directed by Chris Columbus, as you may have heard. It's based off of a J.K. Rowling novel you might have heard of.
I never heard of it.
And
the
screenplay was by Steve Kloves, and you got, like, Daniel Radcliffe. And well, you guys know the actors. Come on, Emma Watson and what's his first name?
Who?
Wait, no. What's his last name? Rupert.
The guy who played Ron. I don't remember his name.
It's Rupert Grint. Yeah.
All right. Wait, they're not brothers, Mike.
Who?
The Weasleys.
Not all of them. The two twins are brothers?
Wait, the girl who plays Ginny is named Bonnie?
What's wrong with that?
I don't know, it's just a weird name. Okay. I mean, it's not even a weird name, it was just weird.
Okay, anyway, you guys know the cast. I'm not going to go over the entire cast, it's a bunch of famous people.
A bunch of famous people?
Oh, it was nominated for 3 Oscars, including Best Art Direction, Set Decoration? Is that a thing?
Best Set Decoration. It's in the Art Direction
best
category.
Best Costume Design and Best Original Score, but it didn't win anything.
That was its nominations at the Academy Awards?
Yeah.
Dang, Set Design, I could see.
A score, I could see. John Williams is a legend. That's what he is.
Wow.
So, yeah.
Or he's just an old man with a conducting stick.
Yeah, or an old man and a fool.
Well.
Wow, okay.
Wow.
I'm a big John Williams fan, so don't get any ideas, podcast listeners.
Wow.
So, were we actually planning on going through all 8 of these movies?
Yes, that is the plan.
We may take some breaks. I think we're going to have a guest next week.
We're going to stagger it, is the plan.
Yeah, so we're going to go 8.
Harry Potter movie.
Other movie.
Regular movie. So, we're going through the whole series if we haven't made that
other
clear.
Harry.
Except
other,
for maybe not the Fantastic Beasts series.
Yeah, well, that's not Harry Potter. That's the Fantastic Beasts.
Wow.
Two separate categories here.
Different franchise.
We get the good movies and the bad.
Oh my gosh. Oh no.
Yikes.
So you would say this is a good movie, Micah?
I would, actually.
Would you care to elaborate on that?
I would, actually.
Wow.
So I rated it, what did I rate it?
3.5.
3.5 stars. I know, I really like this movie. It's not perfect by any means. It's definitely a little rough.
A little.
But it definitely did a very good job in setting everything up. A lot, like, rode on this movie. Like, if you've watched any documentaries or anything, like, I watched a...
Documentaries?
I think I watched the three-part Movies with Mikey series.
Ooh.
And that was really good, but it talks about how much, like, if this movie didn't do well... Then, like, R.I.P. the rest of the Harry Potter movies.
Yeah, no, they were not going to get made after this if it didn't do well.
So, they took a gamble, and it did really well, and that's good, because, you know, I really like these movies in this series.
Well, at least Azkaban came out.
Yikes. Okay. Apparently, this is a very hot take among the film community.
Okay.
I don't like Azkaban at all.
I don't know what.
I understand its significance and especially its importance because it needed to grow beyond the Chris Columbus movies. And it was Alfonso
Cuarón.
He did a great job.
Good.
I don't have any problem with his direction of that movie. I have a problem with the writing in the movie. Wow. So,
well, there's not much they could do about that.
Like, yeah. Well, I mean, they could have written it better.
Oh my gosh.
But that's for another day. We'll talk about. We'll elaborate.
He doesn't like Gravity either.
Gravity's awful.
Gravity's really good.
It's just people breathing for like.
Spoiler
5 hours.
Gravity and Prisoner of Azkaban are both really good.
Listen, we'll get to that when we get to that. Okay.
All right.
what did you rate this, Robbie?
I rated it 4 stars. Wow. The highest I've ever rated a Chris Columbus movie.
Oh boy, that's probably true.
Home Alone was not that high.
So did you rate this higher than Chamber of Secrets? Because I think I like Chamber. Yes. I think I like Chamber of Secrets a little better.
Did I rate it higher?
I think they both suffer from a lot of the same problems.
I forgot Chamber of Secrets was a thing. I always forget that movie exists. Okay.
How, man?
It's just a very forgettable movie.
But it's got Lockhart in it.
Oh my gosh. All right, let's
see.
Yeah, I did rate it a half star lower. I rated Chamber of Secrets a half star lower.
That's... Yeah, I could see that though. I think I rated them the same rating. Both 3.5.
Well, good for you, Mike.
Well, okay. So what are your basic thoughts, Remy?
To be honest, I liked it a lot better than I remembered liking it. Like, I don't know. I have, for some reason, like, in my mind, I remember not liking this franchise very much.
I don't know. He's really whack with movies. He'll be like, he'll watch a movie and he'll sit there and he'll enjoy it. And then a day later, he'll be like, did I like that movie? I don't think I did. I think I hated every second of it.
No, I just remembered this one being kind of boring. That's all.
No, like, it's slow. Its pacing has problems, but...
But I thought... I enjoyed it. There's not too much wrong with it. Like, it's mostly pacing issues that I think it has.
Yeah.
There's not too much else wrong with it. It's got a great cast, of course.
Yeah, the cast is great.
It's got
how long they last.
It's got a good screenplay overall.
Yeah.
And some really great production design, some not as great VFX.
Listen, they were good for their time. It was 2001. Of course, I say that, and Pirates of the Caribbean came out around then.
Dang,
and
man.
And dang, they don't miss with those VFX. They still look good today, and I don't even know how that's possible.
It's kind of crazy.
I have a feeling...
Davy Jones and Two-Face are gonna
age amazingly.
Very well. Like fine wine, guys.
Those are probably the two best CGI characters I could think of.
We're talking Two-Face from The Dark Knight for those.
Not
who
like
are.
Two-Face from Burton Batman or whatever.
Oh no.
Or did he even direct the one that Two-Face is in? Or
was I don't
it just
know.
Or did he not direct that and it was just a sequel?
I don't know.
But
yeah,
the one with Lando Calrissian playing Two-Face, not
for,
him.
For those, I didn't have much else to add. That's pretty much how I feel about it. It's I liked it better than I remembered. It's got a charming cast. It's got some pretty good acting in it too.
Yeah. All right, let's go over to the questions sections.
Questions.
Okay.
What?
I have a question, Remy.
All right.
I have a question.
Shoot. Ask someone who cares.
Oh my god. No. What Dumbledore actor do you like better? The original or the newer one?
Well, in what context?
Just which one do you like
more? Which one do I like better?
Yeah.
This guy?
Yeah. That's the only real answer. We just had to confirm.
Okay, I was about to say, he wouldn't have fit well, I don't know, maybe he would have given a good performance, but he probably wouldn't have fit well with the tone of the later movies.
Still sad that he just died,
yeah,
though.
I know, I'm not saying, oh, good riddance.
Good riddance.
I'm saying he probably wouldn't have given as good of a performance later on.
Yeah,
the tone changes very dramatically.
Yeah, and Dumbledore especially, like, this is very, very Chris Columbus Dumbledore, you know? Very happy.
Chris Columbus directed this Dumbledore, and it is obvious.
Yeah, like, it's like,
says, alas, earwax.
Exactly. Like, I don't know, man. The vibe that this Dumbledore gives off is not the vibe that Dumbledore gives off in the rest of the series at all.
He's not gonna go up and be like, did you put your name in the Goblet of Fire?
Yikes. Why did they change that? Why did they do that? Why?
I wonder if this actor had read the books.
I hope so, because, I mean, there had only been, like, one out at the... Well, I thought there was maybe two out in the time that this one came out.
Luckily, it was a smash hit.
I can't believe the time crunch they had. J.K. Rowling had to write the books while they made the movies, so then when the book came out, they could make it into a movie.
Yikes, man. That is way too much pressure. I would lose it, probably.
Yeah, but I don't know, because, like, the Dumbledore later on in the series, though, is very, like Dumbledore is a complex character, to say the least.
Yes.
And I don't think, as much as I love this Dumbledore, I don't think he's very complex.
Yeah, no, he's a very, like you said, a Chris Columbus kind of surface level jolly guy.
Yeah. He's like Santa Claus, but
he's like
Dumbledore.
He's Wizard Santa Claus.
Wizard Santa Claus that's also Dumbledore.
Wow. So you just wanted to ask which one I liked better?
Yeah. I wanted to just bring it up.
I think it's interesting that, like, how it happened that Dumbledore got recast in the franchise.
Yeah.
Even though it was out of necessity.
Yeah, I like the new guy plenty. I mean... It's kind of annoying that he didn't read any of the books, but that's nothing you can really...
Well, I haven't read more than, like, one or two of the books.
I've only read three, which is sad, but we don't own anymore, wow. So before you guys are all like,
we are Christian homeschoolers. We weren't even allowed to watch the movies till, like...
I was, like, 12.
How old were you, 12?
I think. So, and that was just, like, the first couple until they became PG-13. And then I was 13, and then I watched them.
Wow. So, yeah, you can't go pointing fingers like, oh, this guy didn't even read the books. Fake fan. And then you've read, like,
two. Yeah, for most of her, for, like, until we were, yeah, but he's playing in the movies until, like, I think Harry Potter is one of the few book series that we were allowed to read relatively young. Like, relatively, that had language in it.
When were you allowed to read these?
Like, 13, I think.
That's not relatively young. That's, like, teenager
12,
years.
13, I don't know. Somewhere in there. And I read the first two, and then I read the third one.
All right.
Which I'm not a fan of the Prisoner of Azkaban book either, so.
It's a great movie, Mike.
Anyway, do you have a question?
I've
got a question for you.
Yes, I do have a question, Micah.
Really?
What do you think would have happened if Harry had chosen a toad instead of an owl? Or, well, I guess he didn't even choose
an owl. He would have died. If he would have got a toad instead of an owl, he would have died. What? And I'll tell you why.
Why?
I mean, spoilers for all these movies, but, like... They're old.
Are they old? They're not that
relatively old. This one's 19 years old.
When did Deathly Hallows Part 2 come out?
I don't know.
That was like 2010.
It's like 10 years ago.
Yeah.
Anyway, spoilers for these movies, but I think it's in the first Deathly Hallows. They're flying around. They've all drank Polyjuice Potion.
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
They all look like Harry.
Ugh.
Being chased by Death Eaters.
I don't like the Deathly Hallows
zip,
movies, man.
Zap. A couple of them
zip,
are
zap,
dead.
Zap.
And Hedwig flies right into the bolt that was about to hit Harry. Wow. So, yeah, if
the
it was
toad
a toad...
could have leapt out of his pocket.
The toad would not
it's
have
more
done
portable.
It. No, the toad could not... and would not have done that. And
he
besides,
just
he probably
out of the pocket.
Would have been killed by, what's Hermione's cat's name? Like Crookshanks or something?
Oh,
I don't
gosh.
Know.
The ugliest cat known to man.
Yeah, probably would have been eaten by that cat.
My coffee's still piping hot.
We had to get up at like 6 to be able
to
watch
so
Harry Potter in time,
for those
guys.
Who don't know, we record all of this day of... So this is Monday right now.
Yeah.
We
got up at like 6.
We got up at like 6 in the morning after staying up till like 1 in the morning. So we're running off of very, very little sleep.
Yeah. We're fine.
I was almost falling asleep there at the end.
Yeah.
But now I have some good old caffeine. So Micah, why don't you shoot me a question while I take a drink?
All right. Every time I give you a question, you take a drink.
Oh no.
Okay. Oh, dang, I had a question.
Wow. Strong.
What do you think of... Oh, how did I just lose his name?
Who?
The bad guy from this one.
Who?
Quirrell.
Professor Quirrell.
What do you think of him as a bad guy?
He's a very Chris Columbus bad guy. Yeah, this is a very Chris Columbus movie.
Yeah.
But I don't know. He's... I remember him in the book, and he's about how I imagined he would be.
Yeah,
he's
pretty underwhelming in the book too.
Yeah, he's kind of they spend so much of the screenplay setting up future things.
Yeah, they have so
that they just kind of are
up.
Like, oh right, Professor Quirrell's here too, I guess.
They're like, wait, who looks incredible? Yeah, Snape. Yeah, he looks bad. They're gonna think it's Snape. And then, Quirrell? Yeah, whatever, he's gonna pop in at the end.
Wow, okay, it's a little more set up than that.
I know.
But, yeah, no, he's fine.
Yeah.
You know, like, he's a good starting villain. He's not too overbearing.
I don't know, I just wish he was in the movie more.
Really?
Like, they'll just have, like, occasional shots on him, and, like, that's fine, like, it's supposed to be like a mystery and you're supposed to think it's Snape.
That one shot with him in the iguana. I need that framed. It's
that's
so
a beautiful shot, guys. Yes. If you don't know, he's holding this iguana and it looks like something
I never would have guessed.
Out of the most beautiful painting you've ever seen.
Need an oil painting of that shot?
I do.
Wow.
I need it.
Chris Columbus made art.
Yeah. just because of that frame.
But I thought he was pretty funny. Yeah, he's got jokes.
He's got jokes.
The boy's got jokes.
I mean, if you find a stutter, jokes. I don't know.
No, just his nervous mannerism is funny, Micah.
Well, that's part of this. That's what causes his stutter, Robbie.
No, the nervous mannerism is the stutter is part of the nervous mannerism.
Yeah, exactly.
Micah.
It's all fake. It's a facade.
A facade. What's
no,
a facade?
A facade. Facade.
Okay.
I don't know. He's
fine.
Is that
all you had? Well, you asked me. What am I saying? Yeah, no, I thought he was fine.
All right, give me a question.
How do you think it establishes the tone overall for the franchise, like, and establishes the chemistry between the characters and stuff like that? How do you think it is as a
starting
movie?
Point?
Like, think like Mission Impossible is a launching
yikes.
Movie in its franchise. And then
honestly, you can draw a lot of parallels from that being the starting movie in its franchise and this being the starting movie
oh
in its
gosh.
Franchise.
It escalates and gets more serious with
and
each movie,
better.
Micah. It gets better. Wow. Wow. Wait, so how many Harry Potter movies are there? There are eight
and there's 7.
There's gonna be 8 Mission Impossible
wow.
movies.
The parallels.
The parallels.
Keeps the same cast throughout.
Wow.
Tom Cruise is growing up with this movie.
Wow.
That's more like growing old. But
yeah, I was about to say growing old with this movie.
So yeah, I think it does a good job in setting up like the world.
Yes.
But if you watch this and then you watch even something as far in as like honestly, if you just skip Azkaban, anything is going to be
more. Oh yeah, no.
Azkaban needs to be there. It's
the real pivot point.
It's the transition of tone.
Yeah, it's the real pivot point of the tone of the franchise for sure.
And the lights.
Wow.
You hit this one, you get light.
You got
second movie?
You got some saturation.
You got light.
Got some saturation.
Third movie? You got significantly less light. Fourth movie, you can hardly see.
You can't
Fifth
see
movie,
anything.
It's practically a black screen. Sixth
it's
movie,
just a black screen.
They pump a little light back into it.
Wow. And then after that, it's just...
And then seven and eight,
it's
black
literally
screen.
Just a black screen with some audio in it.
Oh. So it matches the tone of all of them, is pretty much what
wow.
I'm saying.
So you're saying it sets up the world
yeah,
well?
Yeah, it does a good job of setting up the characters. Like, the dynamic between the friends is there. And, like, I don't know. It does a good job. Like, yeah. I think it's a great accomplishment to set up a huge franchise
this. It's kind of crazy, actually, that something didn't go horribly wrong in the production of this movie.
Right?
Like, it's a miracle that the franchise came out as, like, highly acclaimed as it did.
Yeah.
Overall. Like, there isn't, I don't think, a single bad movie in the franchise. Maybe Goblet of Fire,
but even then it's not like
even
an
then
awful
it's not
movie.
bad.
It's just kind of meh compared to the rest.
Yeah,
though I feel like I was talking to somebody the other day and I don't know who it was. It wasn't like it was somebody who
did
had
they
only,
say Goblet was their
it was
favorite?
Somebody who had only seen the movies through once, I think.
Okay.
And they were like, Goblet of Fire is my favorite.
No.
And I was like, you're wrong.
No. Wow.
And that's unfortunate, you know?
I mean, I guess.
Like, I don't know. I like them all.
I mean, I'm glad someone enjoyed a movie.
But honestly, I think I like them better as they go along. Because, and just because
I don't
of
know.
Pacing. Honestly.
I guess.
Like, if you look at the series as a whole, the
well,
pacing
it
gets
just,
better.
It has a lot more, it doesn't have, the final movies in the franchise don't have hardly anything
yeah.
to set up.
By
it's
the
just
time,
all payoffs.
Honestly, by the time you get past, again, Azkaban,
yeah.
they've set up pretty much, all, like, practically everything.
Yeah.
And then, like, the rest of the movies don't have that big weight of, will
gotta,
the audience
gotta set up
get
future
it?
Movies, yeah.
Yeah. So, I don't know.
Yeah, no, that's understandable. I feel like I was going to ask you another question. I had thought of something really good one.
It's my turn.
A real good one, and now I don't
remember
what it is.
My turn.
Okay. Wait, I thought you would actually have
No, I don't have a question.
Is that Martin Scorsese?
No.
Wow.
Gosh, what's a good question for this movie?
Welcome to Recently Locked, my people, where we do not prepare anything, apparently.
Yeah. What do you think of the stuff, like, how much, like, what specifically they cut out for the movie? Like, do you think they should have cut out more, should have cut out less?
Actually, I'm giving props to the screenwriter on this one. What's his face? I don't know. I don't know what his
Cloves.
Name is. Cloves?
Steve Cloves.
He did a great job of adapting this, because it still, like, feels like the book, which is kind of crazy. A lot of adaptations lose that.
Yeah.
But
like a certain other book adaptation that Chris
Oh, no. Yikes. Well, we don't talk about that one. But yeah, no, it's kind of crazy that I think what it does cut out is just more establishing the world stuff, which doesn't necessarily need to be in there, which I'm kind of glad it cut out, because it's already like 2.5 hours or something like that.
Yeah, it's like 2 hours. And
you can feel it.
30 something minutes, I don't know.
You can feel the runtime by the end. You're like, oh my gosh, there's still 40 minutes left in this movie.
Yeah, we were about like, I think it's like 35 minutes in or something, and we hadn't seen Hogwarts yet. And
like,
we're
oh
like,
my gosh.
Oh boy, this is a long one.
Oof. Yeah, no, you can definitely feel the runtime, but it never feels boring by any stretch. So
yeah, and I think it's interesting because the books get progressively longer.
Yeah.
But the movies get a little bit shorter. Like, they never get short.
No. They're never short movies, but they do get shorter.
Because they don't have to, like I said, set up as much.
Yeah.
And, I mean, yeah, I think they cut out a good amount of things. A lot of the stuff actually in the book I find kind of boring.
Wow.
Like, just a lot of random
the
stuff.
The Harry Potter fans are going to come after you, Micah.
I think J.K. Rowling just kind of was like... ghosts. Do a chapter about that.
Although you're more of a Harry Potter fan than I am.
I probably am. I mean, I've spent over $100 in Harry Potter merch.
My homeschooled is showing it. I don't even like Harry Potter.
Actually, I just spent over $100 on two things.
Yeah.
I bought a wand and I bought a scarf. Both at Universal, though, so.
Wow. Okay.
I bought a Cedric Diggory's wand, actually.
Wow. You stole it, Micah?
I stole it. I mean, he's dead, so he doesn't need it.
Wow. Dang. Brutal. But yeah, like I was saying, I think Azkaban might be the only thing I like that's come out of Harry Potter. That I like
really... The only thing that you like?
That I like dang. Really like. Like, no, that's something I'll latch onto and be like, yeah, I really liked that.
I just really don't like that
movie. Because the franchise on a whole, I'm like, take it or leave it.
That movie does so much for the franchise, but I really, out of all of them to turn on, that will be one of the last that I turn. I would probably turn on Goblet of Fire before I turned on Azkaban.
The podcast is done. Thanks for listening.
Okay, guys. Do you have a question?
I do have a question. I remembered what my question was.
Oh, good.
Do you think they spend too much time in the Dursleys' house, Micah? Do you think the movie spends too much time with the Dursleys?
Do you think it like does it mess up the pacing?
Yeah. Do you think that because it's quite a lengthy intro. It's like 20 or 30 minutes, I think. Right.
Yeah. I don't know, because I feel like that's interesting, because I feel like almost everything you see in the house...
Well, I'm not saying I think it's too long. I'm just saying I'm asking
important.
You.
Yeah, I know. I'm just explaining. I think almost everything you see in the house is important. It sets up Harry as a character in the world that he was, like, growing up in.
It does definitely compel you to... it compels the watcher to want Harry to go to Hogwarts.
But I think it might... I think, honestly, it might go on for, like, maybe, like, 5 minutes too long.
I feel like they should cut
like
something.
Shave it just down a little bit. Like, I love that stuff, and it's got some of my favorite lines.
The casting of the Dursleys was some of the greatest of all time.
Right? Like, dang...
It's such a good cast.
Fine day, Sunday.
Fine days.
In my opinion, best day of the week.
Oh, man.
Oh.
Honestly, I think that might be one of my favorite sections of the whole movie, is just the opening with the Dursleys.
Because, like, I don't know, by the time you get to the weird tower thing, because it's not even a lighthouse, the weird tower thing over the ocean.
The ocean view... brick tower.
Yeah. It's, I don't know, I'm kind of bored with the Dursleys. I'm like, why are we still here? Why isn't he on his way?
Luckily, Hagrid swoops in just in time, because if it had gone on longer than that, I would have been like, okay, we need to get the plot moving along, don't we?
Honestly, I think that's kind of the pacing as a whole. I think, like, as much as I like the beginning a lot, I think the beginning has some of, like, the worst pacing.
Oh, yes.
Because, like, it takes him so... Like I said...
The Gringotts and Diagon Alley stuff is just kind of there because it needs to be there.
Yeah, it's all setup stuff. And you're there, like, 30, 40 minutes
and you're
in.
You're like, oh, my gosh.
And nothing technically plot-related has happened. Like,
yeah, I was about to say...
Overall plot, sure. Like, series plot, but not really
I would cite definitely the... when would the second act be? I guess when he gets to Hogwarts, maybe.
I guess.
When he gets his letter, I don't know.
I don't know. No, like, not as early as the letter.
Yeah, I don't know. The main plot of the movie is about the Philosopher's Stone, so I guess it would be during the bank stuff.
Yeah.
But that first act in going into the second act is where it really drags the most.
Yeah. I would
say. Well, maybe in around the third act, too.
See, I think it
picks up quite a bit.
Yeah, because, like, the stuff when he just gets to Hogwarts and then, like, all of the Hogwarts experience in the beginning, that's got some good momentum to it. And I really enjoy that. It sets up Hogwarts well. You get Quidditch, which there's not enough Quidditch in the series.
Bro, Quidditch.
Even if it is with some rough CGI.
I'd imagine the book fans, they're going to be like, we finally get to see Quidditch on screen. And there's like five Quidditch matches
There's not even that many. Okay, let's count the Quidditch matches. There's the Quidditch match in this one. There's the Quidditch match in the second one.
Okay.
There's technically a Quidditch match in the third one.
Is there?
But it's not a whole match, and it's not even focused on it for most of it. It's more just focused on Death Eaters. Then, fourth one, no Quidditch. Fifth one, no Quidditch. Sixth one, Quidditch. So that's three, technically four.
Oh my god.
Then, that's it.
Wow.
There's the World Cup, and you could argue that, like, they cut away. And everybody was mad. This was about to be professional top-tier Quidditch. They've gotten us as an audience hyped for this freaking Quidditch. And then they're like, let the games begin. Cut away. And then, you know,
he's an artist. Ron in the tent.
There's no one like Crumb.
There's no one like Crumb, yes. Yeah.
Probably the best part of Goblet of Fire.
I would imagine being like a huge fan of the books, and just me personally, I'd be like, bro, we get to see a Quidditch match on screen, and then the entire franchise, it's just like four in total.
Right, like.
And you're like, what?
Yikes.
What?
I know Quidditch wasn't like super important to any of the plot, but.
No, it's not.
Man, I miss me some Quidditch.
There's a, you know, for how rough the CGI looks, the Quidditch match in this movie doesn't look awful.
Yeah, so. No, it's fun. I think I like the second Quidditch match. So it's probably between Chamber of Secrets Quidditch match and Half-Blood Prince Quidditch matches, like my two favorite Quidditch matches.
You have them ranked, Mike.
Yeah. And I mean, Ron does well in the Half-Blood Prince Quidditch match.
Ronald Micah?
Because he's actually playing Quidditch by then.
Wow. Wow. I kind of forgot about that, honestly. Wow.
What were we talking about before
I don't know.
Quidditch?
I had asked you about the pacing with the Dursleys.
Yeah,
but...
and somehow we got onto Quidditch.
Yeah. Did you have any other questions, Micah? Questions?
What do you think of Hogwarts in
Hogwarts?
This movie? Like, Hogwarts as a location.
As a location? As a setting for the film?
Kind of, yeah. Just like Hogwarts as a whole. Like what they did with it in the movie.
You know, it feels like Hogwarts. You know, what are you going to do? Like, it's a magical castle, and it feels like that. It just doesn't feel as grand as in the later movies.
No, I think the thing is, it doesn't feel, I think, because I was trying to keep notice of this, how many, like, exterior shots they had, and how many exterior, like, even things they had, and...
Oh, it's a minuscule now.
Very, I think compared to like, all of the there's other like ones. Three shots of Hogwarts from the outside.
There's
and it
the
makes
flying,
it...
there's the flying scene, the broom scene outside, and then you've got like a couple exterior shots, and that's it.
Like them coming pretty up on much. The boat, and then that one shot that's just randomly in there after Harry goes to sleep.
Wow.
But I don't know. I think it makes it feel. It makes Hogwarts feel more just like a set.
Yeah, it does, definitely.
And that's always unfortunate, I feel. Like I said, I'm going to cite Azkaban again, and I don't like the movie, but like I said, it does a lot for the franchise. They made Hogwarts actually feel like a place in that movie.
Oh, yeah, they're wandering everywhere.
They made a real geography for it.
Dang,
they had
man,
a lot of
so
outside
good.
Locations. They were constantly walking from place to place.
It's so good.
And you really... From then on, you like, and I mean, that's really the last movie that's super Hogwarts focused, though.
Yeah, I mean, but, there's the Battle of Hogwarts at the end.
But even then, that's not like
yeah,
Hogwarts
it's not like,
focused.
It's not like
it's just a battle.
It's more everything blowing up.
Kind yeah, of. It's like all of Hogwarts being blown to smithereens.
Yes.
So yeah, Hogwarts. Yeah, it just I don't know. It always is unfortunate because it feels. it makes the movie, like, with the pacing that they have and the shots that they use, it makes Hogwarts feel very tight and very, like, a set.
And very, yeah, it feels very blocked in. Like, there's only a couple hallways you can go down.
Yeah, I don't know. It almost, like, thinking about it, I almost feel claustrophobic in a weird way.
Yeah. No, it's, yeah. It just adds to the overall kind of weird feeling of this movie. Like, it's got charm to it, but it just feels kind of weird with the pacing and, once again, like, a lot of other factors contribute to that.
Some, like, the pacing, some of the, like at Hogwarts. But it's still fun, stuff. Though. Yeah, no, it's still a really good movie. And like I said, it's hard to view this movie just as its individual movie because it did so much to start the franchise and it set up so much.
I can't imagine, I'd imagine me reviewing this back when it first came out, if I was as old as I am now. You... I was about to say, if I was as old as I was now back then, back when it came out, I don't know. I don't know if I'd like it as much.
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't
know. Like, standing on
it's weird.
Because when we watched these movies, we were borrowing them from somebody who had them all, and we just watched them so fast.
Yeah, we just grind the grind.
The grind, yeah. I think I watched, I think it was, what's the first PG-13 of the movies? I think it's Phoenix, right? No. Is Goblet? No.
Goblet should be PG-13 with what's in it.
Yeah, I think Goblet is the first one, because I know Azkaban's not.
Hold on, let me check. So what's after Chamber of Secrets?
Azkaban, which I know is PG, and then it's Goblet. Okay. So I'm pretty sure if Goblet of Fire is PG-13, then yes.
Yeah, it is.
Okay, so yeah, I think we watched Goblet of Fire on my 13th birthday.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that.
Yeah. Because we were watching them first around my birthday.
Well, there you go.
And I was like, hey, I'm 13
now. Hey, I'm 13 now. I can watch PG-13.
I can watch all of the movies.
All of the movies? Yes.
Yes, obviously. No, but anyway.
Wow.
Yeah, we watched them all very fast, and I think if we hadn't, I almost would have lost momentum to want to watch anymore.
Yeah.
Because, like, those first two feel very similar. Like Chamber of Secrets has a lot of the same problems that this one does.
It's a lot tighter.
No, it is. It's a lot tighter, and dang, I think it's better.
It has a good screenplay, man.
And it's got Lockhart.
Chamber of Secrets has a good screenplay. You can quote me on that.
Yeah, I think Chamber of Secrets is honestly a lot better than this one.
It's funny. The entire franchise, every movie that I used to, like, that I disliked the first time I watched it, like, all of my opinions have just switched, like, swapped.
I was never a huge fan of this one.
I now like Chamber of Secrets and Azkaban, like, some of the most, and I used to hate those. Those used to be my least favorite.
See, I still don't like Azkaban. Like I said, I can appreciate what it did for the series and what it, like, because, like I said, like I keep saying,
it's pretty much a technically perfect.
Yeah, the direction is amazing.
It's kind of crazy.
I just don't like the movie. Like, I don't like the story. I don't like the writing. I don't like the movie.
Wow.
Do you have any other questions?
I think we've covered pretty much all the basic, like, all of the pretty much biggest flaws are, in our opinion, biggest flaws of the movie.
Yeah.
I think maybe the only other thing I would ask is, what do you think is the best part of the movie? Like, the best, like, aspect of it.
Like, aspect as a whole?
Yeah, just as the movie as a whole, what is the greatest overall part of it?
The cast, for sure.
Oh, yes.
Because the cast throughout all these movies, because, I mean, it's the same cast besides, like, Dumbledore. They're amazing.
It's literally, like, insane.
The fact that
they had cast someone bad, like a bad actor as Harry Potter.
Yikes, right? They had to take such a gamble.
They lucked out so much. Whew. It's kind of insane.
And, like, the fact that they actually got all these kids to grow up with these movies, it's just insane. Like,
it's
looking at these movies as a whole, as a series, it's a huge achievement.
It's like MCU levels of casting, but the cast is better than the MCU. but yeah, no, I just wanted to ask. I think I would probably tend to agree with you that the cast is probably the best aspect of it. Outside of that, I would probably maybe say the production design and maybe the lighting. lighting is the lighting fantastic.
This is probably some of the best lighting that you'll get in the series.
Oh, yes. Yeah, no, it looks great.
But like I said, there's a lack of lighting in later entries.
I was about to say, it goes from it looks great to it looks gray very quickly.
All right, so I just set up, I'm setting up a list on my Letterboxd of our overall...
Okay, are we going to rank these as we go through?
As a podcast group, what? We are going to rank them
okay,
all.
Okay, this is going to be...
Not individual.
Azkaban has to be at the top.
We have to... No, Azkaban is not going to be at the top. As a group, though, we're going to have to decide on an official, recently logged ranking of these movies.
So right now, according to recently logged's rating... Philosopher's Stone is number one in the Harry Potter franchise.
Of the one movies so far. Yeah.
Wow, that's pretty amazing, Micah.
But yeah, I think that's all the thoughts I really have on it. It's a great achievement, and it's a fun, charming movie with a great cast, and, you know, it's fun.
Yeah, it's a fun movie. But you turn this on some nights.
It's
long. It is very long.
You have to be in the mood for it. And it's got some pacing issues.
But it's fun. You know, I'll probably watch this with my kids someday.
Yeah.
That's more than I can say for most Chris Columbus movies.
Yikes. I mean, you gotta give him that a lot of his movies
have become
classics.
I'll give him Home Alone.
Home Alone is a classic.
Home Alone's fun.
Home Alone is fun. It's not great, but it's fun.
But yeah, outside of that, I don't really like Chris Columbus' stuff at all. Yikes. Adventures in Babysitting fans, but it's not great.
It's not great, but it's fine.
I guess.
Fine.
I guess. Yeah. So any closing thoughts? Anything that you wanted to touch on that you hadn't yet?
I just did my closing thoughts, but I already did this.
Quite right. But I need to announce our blocky format.
Right. Okay. What about you, Ravi? Do you have any final thoughts? Any last words?
Like I said before, a lot of my opinions have kind of swapped on these movies. Outside of this one, I kind of was just indifferent to this the first time I saw it, and I'm still kind of just indifferent to it. It's good, but I don't love it. But like I said, I'm not a Harry Potter fan, so
yeah.
I'm not usually a fantasy guy, so
yeah. He's usually a lame guy.
A lame guy. I really like sci-fi. I wish there was more, like, really fantastic sci-fi
like,
out there.
Like, yeah, but you gotta specify the type of sci-fi. You want more, like...
I like...
Ex machina sci-fi.
I like almost every kind of sci-fi. Name one kind of sci-fi that I don't like.
Star Wars.
I love Star Wars.
No, you don't.
I gave Empire 5 stars.
You literally are over
stars.
Here... You're over here, like... Star Wars.
Okay, the prequels and the sequel trilogy is rough. The Last Jedi I liked, but I did not like Force Awakens or Rise of Skywalker.
Okay, but I'm saying that genre of sci-fi as a whole.
I like it. I like the original trilogy a lot. So I think that's proof enough that I like that kind of sci-fi.
Yeah, but I feel like you've said that you like the Ex Machina, Arrival.
Oh yeah, no, I love
more thought. Not that we've seen Ex Machina.
No,
don't
no,
get
no,
any
no.
Ideas.
But don't get any ideas. But I love kind of not dystopian,
very
but like
thought provoking.
Yeah, Like 2001 sci-fi, 70s,
is supposed to be like an examination of like what technology
I will
could
say
become or
I'm
what
not,
humanity could become.
I'm not
in
that
the
into disaster movie kind of sci-fi. A lot of the time,
can you give an example?
Independence Day, which I mean is good, but I'm not really that.
It's not my kind of movie. Okay.
I will say it's
Independence
it's all right.
Day. I will reference Lindsay Ellis for this. It's fun.
It is a fun movie,
but it's not great. It's dumb as rocks. To
it
quote
really
her
is.
Directly,
it really is. But yeah, I would cite that as probably the only kind of sci-fi that I don't really like that much. In the more like. Fantasy sci-fi kind of mix.
You know what I wish was better?
Like a lot of the mythology obsessed sci-fi, which is why I'm not as into Star Wars as I could be, because it's a lot of kind of like mystic.
You know what I wish was better?
You know what?
War of the Worlds. That had so much potential.
War of the Worlds. That thing was shot like it was Minority Report, but it wasn't as good as Minority Report.
It had
Report.
So much potential.
It was weird, man.
Poor writing.
It was
the
weird.
The writing. It's so depressing. But, like, yeah, top sci-fi is, you got, like top sci-fi I can think of, you got, like, your Star Wars and stuff like that, but you got, like, 10 Cloverfield Lane.
Oh, yes.
And, like, yes. Arrival. And yes. stuff like that.
Yeah, I think that's probably, well, not my favorite genre, because I would say maybe comedies are my favorite genre, but like good comedies. Wow. Like, yeah, whenever I say I like a genre, I mean like the cream of the crop of that genre usually, because there are some awful sci-fi movies,
I just like good movies, Rebby. Wow. I don't think there's a real...
I like good movies.
I don't think there's a category specifically that I don't like.
I'm just more... movies. I'm probably more likely to watch something because
I like sci-fi movies.
I really like sci-fi.
I like fantasy movies. I like comedy movies.
Ooh.
I like drama.
There's an example of action movies that I really like.
Spectral by the Netflix original.
No, Ghost in the Shell.
How did you get worse? I was saying Spectral because I was like, oh, there's a bad sci-fi movie. And then he was like, Ghost in the Shell. And he got worse.
No.
The live-action Ghost in the Shell. I was going to say the
Guardians movies.
Yeah.
I love those movies.
But dang, Ghost in the Shell.
I like either really, really serious sci-fis or really, really goofy sci-fis. Yeah, like...
What about Aeon Flux?
No.
Based off of the hit anime.
Oof. Yikes, there are some bad sci-fi movies.
What about Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy?
Had good puppets.
iRobot.
iRobot, it's pretty good.
Minority Report?
Minority Report, yes.
AI, that, artificial intelligence.
Minority Report, once I get the Blu-ray of it, I am going to watch that thing.
Tron.
All the time. All the time.
Tron Legacy.
Let me tell you. We need to do Minority Report on here sometime.
Logan's Run.
No!
No!
Howard the Duck, Micah?
Yikes.
That's the lowest rated
okay,
sci-fi
well,
movie
anyway,
I've ever
anyway,
seen.
Anyway, do we want to go... Let's go into what we've watched, though it's
that
kind
movie
of depressing.
Is...
We have watched nothing.
Okay, you guys can quote me on this. Howard the Duck is the worst movie, like, probably ever.
So you think, hey, everybody's in quarantine. Obviously, they
must
should be watching
must
more
be
movies.
Must be buckling down on the movies, you know?
Nope. We've
so much
been
free
so
time.
Busy.
My workload has literally, I think... in hours doubled since.
I think we've all been more busy since this
since
is,
quarantine
like all of
started.
Our family has been more busy since this started than before, so yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway, we have watched like what's that like four films. Okay, so let's start out on the 10th. So we skipped 5 days there. Onward
we watched
on the 5th.
Onward on the 5th.
And then we skipped all the way to the 10th, which is sad on its own. We went 5 days without watching a movie.
And we do a movie podcast. Come on,
that's
guys.
Depressing. That's what that is. I remember in the Knives Out Everyday Challenge, we were watching like two... I was watching
Who's
anyway.
This we? Yeah.
I was watching at least two movies every day for a week.
That's kind of insane.
That was amazing.
That's not healthy. But...
That was beautiful. That's what that was. That's a movie in the morning, a movie in the afternoon. The way it should be.
Wow.
Anyway, on the 10th, we watched one of the worst animated movies I think I've ever seen.
Wow. I don't believe that. I don't believe that.
Well, no, it doesn't rank with the likes of... of Wonder Park and Adam's Family.
Oof,
but
man.
It's definitely down there.
Oof.
We have Angry Birds
2. The Angry Birds movie 2, Micah.
Yikes.
Not only is it a bad movie, it has a bad title.
Yikes.
Yeah, no, it's not great.
I gave this a star.
Yeah, it's a sequel to the Angry Birds movie,
which was trash.
Which, I mean, it wasn't awful.
It was pretty bad,
I guess, but it wasn't good by any stretch of the imagination.
Poor Bill Hader.
It shouldn't have gotten a
Why
sequel.
Why Bill Hader?
It should not have gotten
Why
a sequel.
Why Bill Hader?
I can't believe Bill Hader did this. Why would he do this to us?
Anyway.
Or Awkwafina for that matter.
Yeah, Awkwafina too. But like, man, this is bad writing.
It's
bad
not great.
Direction.
It has some fun
it
stuff.
It has some fun moments, right?
Yeah.
Like, and that's what you get with
the
a lot
heist,
of these.
The heist is probably the best part of the movie, and to be honest, it's not even that good a lot of
It's not, like, a good heist. Like,
yeah.
It's like they were going for, like, like a super overcomplicated heist like you see in a heist movie, but they weren't self-aware enough to try to at least make it funny.
Yeah, like there's like one, yeah, like I said, it's the most fun of the movie and it's not that good, if yeah. that's any indication.
Yikes. This movie is rough. The plot, I hate. Every part of the plot, I hate.
The villains, yikes. Yeah, it's bad. Sorry, guys. Especially
the end with the villain. I hate it so much.
If you are the kind of moviegoer who just watches movies and doesn't really care much about assessing them in any way, you might enjoy this, maybe.
I don't think I ever added. Did I add this to my 2019 rank?
What? I don't know. Maybe.
I don't know.
I'm not sure.
Anyway, continue talking.
Yeah, but like I said, if you're the kind of person who just wants to turn their brain off and enjoy a dumb movie, this is fine. You know, like, it'll keep you engaged a little bit.
There are better dumb movies.
Yeah, there are much better dumb movies you could turn on, but,
I did not edit
that. Man, I love a good dumb movie once in a while.
Occasionally, yeah. But this is not
this is not one of those. But yeah, what did we watch after that, Micah?
I don't know. You have your phone
on the 11th,
right,
I believe. Yes, I think, yeah. We watched the next day. The next day.
Oh boy, we went fast.
Okay,
here.
So this went from 0 to 100 really, really fast. From 10th on the 10th, we watched Angry Birds movie 2, and then on the 11th, we watched The Passion of the Christ for Easter. Oof,
this was the first time we had watched it.
Yeah, this was our second rated R movie, our second official rated R movie.
I give it.
It's kind of crazy.
I give it. Hold on.
You're changing your rating.
I gave it 2.5 stars.
He pulled up his diary entry and just swooped it down.
Only a half star.
Yeah, yeah. But yeah, this was the second rated R movie we'd ever seen. Passion of the Christ.
I understand.
2004.
I understand it.
But
I don't.
I have a singular statement like that sums up my thoughts on
the movie.
Yeah.
And I don't think it's very well made.
Oh, really?
I don't know. Like, it's got
it's,
good
it's
cinematography.
Well directed, man.
Cinematography's nice. I hate the editing.
The editing can be rough sometimes.
Me. The writing, I think the writing was kind of sloppy.
If they would have left out the quote-unquote visions and stuff, I think it would have been a bit more, like, bearable.
Yeah, I wish they would have kept it.
It almost feels goofy.
Because they're trying to bring like a grounded.
It feels like a Christian music video in those parts.
Right?
Is what it feels like.
Like I said, they're trying to bring like a grounded feel to the story,
which they do.
But then they throw goofy stuff like the visions and Satan being like a goofy ripoff of Voldemort.
It's so weird. I don't know why they decided. I mean, they needed. In their mind, they probably needed to put in some abstraction of Satan somehow, but there were so many other ways you could do it. I would not have gone with the shaved guy with maggots coming out of his face kind of thing.
like an ugly Voldemort, but with a nose.
Yeah, no, it's not great. I gave it 2 stars. I think if you are a believing Christian, then it does do some good. It did do something for me, because it is a good reminder of what Christ went through. If you do believe
that's like,
which I do,
I think it does that
yes,
really well.
It's a great reminder of that. So it does that really well. But as a film itself, outside of it having really fantastic makeup and production design.
I like the cinematography of it, too.
The cinematography is really good, too. And the lighting in this is really great, too.
Yeah, so, like, on a production side of things...
On a production side of things, this thing, it looks fantastic.
The editing goes into the, like, categorized as production, right?
No.
No, yeah. So, okay. So, yeah, production side of things, love this movie.
Well, I mean, yeah, that's post-production, because production's whenever they're shooting that sort of thing.
So, cinematography, lighting, makeup.
Delicious.
All of that stuff is great.
I don't know is that weird?
That is weird. Don't say delicious to this movie.
it's a really nice, it's a really technically all right movie, but it's really, the script doesn't do much.
I don't like the script at all.
A lot of the flashbacks kind of are just kind of there, so they can have quotes from the Bible.
I feel like they just did a bad job. I don't know. Honestly, with the writing of this story, like, if you're looking to write this story into a movie, I think it's a bad job.
If you're not a Christian, you probably won't enjoy it very much.
If I wasn't a Christian and I didn't know the story, I would be like, this is the most whack movie I've ever seen.
I'd be pretty turned off.
Why does it have so much gore in it? I'm leaving.
I'd be pretty turned off. I mean, it does do a great job. I think I read this on a review somewhere. I don't remember who it was, but it does do a great job of showing how monotonous the process was.
Yeah. And how ridiculous the entire story
is. Yeah, no, like
how all of that happened.
It captures that really well. But as for Jesus in the movie, it doesn't do as great of a job. The guy who plays him does a great job with what they give him.
But yeah, I think like I said, it does a great job of capturing like how ridiculous people acted.
Exactly.
And how like horrible what happened to him was.
And that's the most real feeling part of the movie.
Yeah. But like, yikes, as a whole, just I wouldn't watch this movie except for specifically like Easter.
Yeah, I'll probably watch it on Easter again. I enjoyed it enough that I would, but like I said, I give it 2 stars. I mean it's a good reminder to me personally, but as a film on the whole, it's a lacking a bit.
Yeah, anyway. We just spent like 15 minutes talking about that.
Yeah.
Then on what day was this? We just went from 0 to 100
back to zero.
But like a good zero.
Yeah, this is at least a good zero.
We watched B-movie on the 14th. So we gave it a couple of days break. We weren't just like, well, we just watched Passion of the Christ. Do you want to watch B-movie now?
Yeah, we watched Passion of the Christ. Let's watch B-movie.
Oh, man. I gave B-movie
4 stars. I feel like we talked about this not too long ago.
I feel like we did too, but I don't care. Yeah, look, we just did it
a couple of episodes ago.
So we won't talk about it in much
depth. I gave it 3 stars, I think.
I gave it 4 stars, which is generous. Love this movie.
It's so much fun.
There's
a lot of really well written jokes in it. But it's just kind of incoherent a lot of the time.
It's amazing though. I'll watch this any day.
Yeah, no, turn this on anytime. That's my motto.
Anyway, moving on. Since we talked about it recently and we just spent a lot of time on Passion of the Christ, we'll move on.
We're wrapping it up.
On the 16th, we watched 12 Angry Men, and this was the first time I watched it.
We watched the Criterion, so it wasn't the TV cut, it was the full cut.
Yeah.
Which, yikes, the TV cut would be pretty rough, I'd imagine.
Like, I can think of hardly anything that, like, I would cut nothing out.
What did you rate it?
I rated it 4.5.
Yes.
Not quite 5. I still think it has...
It's pretty much technically perfect.
I think it still has, like, some... Just, and it's nothing an issue. Like, looking at this movie, I think also it's pretty much technically perfect.
Yeah.
But I think just watching the movie, I think it's missing something.
Really?
Like, I want, like, something. I don't know what it is.
The cast couldn't is tell so you. Good,
cast
man.
Is great.
It's Writing's so insane.
Insane. Like, insanely good.
For anyone who's ever tried to write a screenplay, go watch this movie. It literally will knock your socks off. It's insane.
The fact that it's 12 guys sitting
stuck in a room. Locked in a room.
They leave the room like once to go to the bathroom.
It's insane. It shouldn't be interesting. And yet, it's gripping.
I have to say, I was right the whole time.
Wow. Yeah, Micah, he watched the opening courtroom scene.
For something, I guess. I don't know.
It's in, like, the 50s. It came out in the 50s or something.
No, I didn't. I was, like, just, it panned onto the guy
It panned
in question,
onto the guy.
And I was like, he's innocent.
He's innocent. And then it dissolves into the, I'm like, well, we'll see, I guess. And then, yeah, I had seen this one time before, and I loved it then. I still love it. It's, like, a technical masterpiece.
This is great. I would watch this almost any time.
It is a masterclass in editing and pacing
dialogue. The cinematography is meh. Like, it's not bad, but...
No, I mean, it
doesn't take away from the movie.
No, it doesn't take anything away, but it could have been better.
The blocking is good, though.
The blocking is good.
I mean, not, like, Knives Out good. I think Knives Out... I'm being serious, though. I think Knives Out has some of the best blocking I've ever seen in a movie.
I mean, it is good, yeah. I suppose. I just didn't give much thought to it. This blocking is a lot more important. If the blocking had been bad, it would have ruined the movie.
Yeah.
12 Angry Men, not Knives Out.
But anyway, yeah, it's a great movie. You should go watch it. Watch the
full version. Go buy the Criterion Blu-ray.
Not the mini version
or whatever.
No, don't spend $40.
It's only an hour and a half. It's only
an hour and a half. Don't listen to him. Don't spend $40 for an hour and a half of movie.
Of pure cinema is what it is.
Anyway, yeah, I think that's about ends it. And I had a quote already ready.
Wow.
I'm so good at this. I should be getting paid.
It's Harry Potter. Of course you can find a quote easily.
Okay, who do you want to be?
I don't know. You have the deeper voice, so I'll let you go with the first one.
All right.
I have to channel my inner 7-year-old, apparently.
Yeah.
No, he turns 11 in this.
Wait.
But I don't know how old Daniel Radcliffe was.
Yeah, no, I thought... He grows up with... I thought they were 10 and...
No, he turns 11. That was his 11th birthday.
Right. We just watched this. How am I so bad?
Okay. Okay. Forgive me, Luke, for my British accent.
Yikes, yeah. Sorry, Luke. You're a wizard, Harry.
I'm a what?
I'm a what?
I'm a what?
Yikes. Hey, and it's 10 o'clock.
Wow. Capping it off at an hour.
Also, Luke, Jojo Rabbit, just tell me when it comes out in the UK.
It's pretty dang good.
Because it's a good movie, and I would do it with you on the podcast.
I guess I have to leave this in now.
Yeah, this is a message to Luke.
Why not just text him?
Because.
Wow.
Message to Luke. It's better, and you know, you want him to hear my voice.
Then send him a voice message.
No, I'm not going to send him a voice message.
Okay.
Anyway.
Wow. Goodbye, guys.
Bye.